This episode of the Sloopcast is brought to you by the Med Canadian Barbecue Company. Med Canadian is an Ohio-based company located in Cary, Ohio, in northwest part of that great state, where they say our seasoning will take your barbecue from good to great. Great seasonings such as the Tube Border. I put some Tube Border, Jared, on some eggs this morning. I know you do all the time. Fantastic.
Yeah.
The Cary steak. I put that on some burgers the other day. Fantastic. Mm-hmm. The Sonoran Heat. I put that on some chicken earlier in the week. Fantastic. Or the Old Fashioned, just like the drink here. You can't go wrong with any of those great seasonings and much more over at themedcanadianbbq.com. That is themedcanadianbbq.com. Don't forget to use that promo code for 10% off. Use Sloopcast10, Sloopcast10 at checkout for 10% off your entire order. Med Canadian Barbecue Company, where they have your butt covered.
This episode of the Sloopcast is also brought to you by the Iron Bean Coffee Company. The Iron Bean Coffee Company is an Ohio-based, marine-owned, small-batch, roast-to-order coffee company. Did I hit all of them on that one, Kyle? I was doing that one from the top of my head. I think I forgot small-batch. Small-batch, roast-to-order, veteran-owned, Ohio-based coffee company. All of their beans are fair trade certified and USDA organic. So you know that your beans are moral because that's a thing. And you know that they're fresh and you know that there's no junk in there that's going to make you sick. All of the beans are imported directly from Colombia, Brazil, Uganda, Honduras, Peru, Ethiopia, Indonesia, and other far off lands. Gift cards are available if you're maybe you got Mother's Day coming up. I know lots of moms out there like coffee, because there's a lot of coffee options over at the Iron Bean Coffee Company. Maybe you're not sure which one she wants. Get her a gift card. That would be my recommendation to you. Or if you want to, if mom likes all sorts of different coffees, you can get the whole shebang, which is it 15, 14? I forget. You can look it up for yourself. I'm not going to swear to it, but it's a bunch of different coffees in sample sizes. So you can find the one either for yourself or for your mom or whoever you might be buying a gift for. You can find that right there. Right there, you could just give them the whole shebang and they can try them out and decide on their own. So you can find all of that and more at the Iron Bean Coffee Company. That's ironbeancoffee.com, America's local coffee roaster.
How's it going, YouTube?
How's it going, YouTube?
Everyone's had a great weekend.
Yeah, I've had a very productive weekend, which is nice because I don't always. But it's like the first weekend in almost an entire month in which I didn't do any like work. And by work, I mean like real life work. I don't mean this work because I always doing this. But you know, just got a lot done around the house that I haven't really been able to get done a lot lately. So
yeah,
it feels nice.
Yeah. Getting ready to go back in the office here in the next couple of weeks. Got to do some clothes shopping. Got that COVID weight. So,
hey man, I feel like I'm fairly neutral on the COVID weight.
Yeah. I haven't gained much, but it's enough. Enough where it's like, I should.
You know what you need? You need some Iron Bean coffee because that's a natural appetite suppressant. And the caffeine can help you lose weight.
I did. Yep. Yeah. I did get
you
some
pound it,
Iron Bean coffee. It's a slow process. I'm not a coffee person, but I'm slowly going through that bag.
Yeah. There you go. If anyone out there, I do the, what do you call it? Intermittent fasting. And man, like a pot of Iron Bean Coffee Company really helps me get to like, cause I don't eat until I get to like 1:00 PM. And a nice pot of Iron Bean Coffee really helps that process. All right. That's enough. We need to get to the actual show. YouTube, that was a bonus just for you. All right. Let's join the audio only listeners. We've got barbecue back here. You're all invited. Welcome to the Sloopcast. How are you doing today, Kyle?
I'm doing pretty well. How are you doing today, Jared?
You know, I don't really have any complaints. I was just telling the YouTube people that I didn't have to do any, like the IRL job, the one that actually pays my bills. Didn't have to do any work this weekend for the first time in a while. So, you know, just had one of those like late spring, early summer, like getting shit done sort of days.
Yep. Yep. Hear you. Spring's in the air now. It's warm. It's getting warm outside, starting to get outside a little bit more. Yeah. It's football is starting to get behind us now. We're not quite deep, but we're knees deep into the wasteland right now.
Well, this is the start of the wasteland.
It is. Yep.
Once you get past the draft, that's it. You're officially in the sports wasteland. You got nothing but that. What do you call it when you take the baseball bat? I just said baseball bat. I ruined the joke. It's over.
Good job, Jared. Good job. All right, let's get into it. Before we talk about the NFL draft, just one bit of Buckeye news here. Actually, some big news here. Potential starter or rotation with the wide receiver, Jameson Williams, officially transferring out of Ohio State. There are about seven teams that he's looking to transfer, but the leading candidates, Jared, Alabama and that team up north.
Other notable
teams too that he has on his list: Texas A&M, Florida, Sparty, and USC.
Why would you go to that team up north or that team up north state?
Especially after seeing
Texas A&M, Florida, USC, and Bama sitting there, and if those teams want you, why on earth would you go to either of the dumpster fires up north?
Especially after seeing what Sparty produced in the NFL draft this year. A big fat zero. First time in 80 years that Sparty did not get a player drafted.
That's
saying a lot.
That's terrible. If Bama wants you and Bama can put you on the field, go to Bama.
Heck, Northwestern. I guess we're going right into the NFL draft here. Heck, Northwestern, Jared, got two.
Well, I don't want to move rounders. I don't want to move away from Jameson Williams yet.
Yeah.
One, Ohio State will be fine. Like, Ohio State's insanely deep at wide receiver. I said it on Twitter. I don't have it in front of me, so I'm just going to, this is approximately what I said. I go, how many Ohio State teams since the year 2000 would Jameson Williams been one of the two best wide receivers on the team? .. The answer is more than 12.
Yeah.
The
one downside with Jameson Williams though, Jared, is he brings that deep threat. We saw it a couple of plays last year.
Did you say a downside? Or you mean like a downside to him transferring?
Yes, downside of him transferring is the deep threat. Like he has that speed. We saw that a couple of plays last year.
Oh, for sure. Against Clemson.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it's not like, oh, Williams isn't going to matter. I think having that depth, that rotation for that third, even the second guy too, depending on the down and yardage too. I think can make a somewhat effect for this offense moving forward. Now it's not going to be a big effect, but it is an effect nonetheless.
Ohio State will be fine. Jameson Williams started for Ohio State, I believe 100% of the games last year. He was not going to start this year because they moved Garrett Wilson from the slot out to one of the primary wide receiver spots. And that was going to move Jameson Williams to the bench, which is probably why you see him transfer. But on one hand, Jameson Williams is excellent. This is the this is an example of a, you know, a strong swimmer jumping ship, not because they had to, but because they could. Yeah, absolutely. Best of luck to him wherever he goes. I guess Nomad is now with us. Welcome to the chat, Nomad.
Yep, and the biggest ones right now as of
but this morning, is basically to me the wide receiver equivalent of losing Joe Burrow. Yeah. Does it suck? Yeah. Can he have success elsewhere? Yeah.
Yeah.
Did Ohio State do just fine with Haskins and Fields? Yeah.
Yeah. This is a top 100 prospect for that 2019 class, number 13 receiver in the country for that 2019 class. So it's no pushover, but the early transfer crystal balls, well, maybe not early, but the two transfer crystal balls both have him going to Alabama.
Yeah. And I'm not trying to blow up any, it's behind the paywall over at the Scoop, but there, and I'm not saying done deal, but there are rumblings over there that might be the direction he's heading. Mm-hmm. And I hope he does well in every single game, unless they play Ohio State, in which case, you know, loyalty takes over.
Yes.
Sorry.
Yeah. Absolutely. Absolutely. All right. Any other news that you would like to bring up before we get into the NFL draft results?
Let's talk about the draft.
All right. Ohio State, 10 players once again for the second straight year. 10 players get drafted from the Ohio State University.
Yeah. Not a top heavy draft. Like maybe because they had also, this is Kyle has. I mean, I know this is Ohio State's first time doing it. I'd be interested to know if Bama's ever done it, because I feel like maybe they could have. 2 years in a row with 10 players.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm curious how many Alabama has. I haven't looked, but I'm sure that they probably right there at 10 or more. I would say of the past 8 years, I would say my guess would be like, six
that feels more. That feels like a lot, Kyle.
Yeah,
that feels like a lot. It's again not super top heavy. Only one player drafted in the first round, and that would be Justin Fields, who fell way too far.
Way too far. Chicago ended up getting him in the 11th pick there, which is a steal. It is a steal. Like, he was projected the number two, number three overall pick in most projections. But yeah, it's Chicago got a steal here. And I think once he got drafted, there was just an outcry in our Discord here. Again, check out our Discord. Yes, check out our Discord. That's where we mainly hang out. We talk and all that. Links in the doobly-doo, as Jared's trying to say here.
Well, I was actually pointing to the graphic.
A lot of people not really liking Fields going to Chicago. Obviously, Chicago, it's going to make Chicago better, hopefully. But I don't think there's weapons there to help Justin Fields currently.
Kyle, who's the best Chicago quarterback of all time?
I'm just going to keep drinking. Walter Payton. Yes.
You know, that might be true. But this is Jimmy Harbs, McMahon. It's not a place where quarterbacks have success. Historically speaking, it's kind of a graveyard for quarterbacks. I feel real bad for Justin Fields. I did not want to see him end up in Chicago.
You know, like I'm looking quickly at a.
I really wish San Francisco. Listen, you will never convince me, not in a million years, that Justin Fields was not in the top two quarterbacks of this draft. You want to have a Trevor Lawrence discussion? We can have a Trevor Lawrence discussion. Mm-hmm. No one else. It was one and two. A clear line of delineation. And then others. And you'll never convince me otherwise. Even I don't care if we look back at this 5 years from now and some of those other guys had good careers and maybe Justin Fields didn't. I'll just blame Chicago. Even then, you won't convince me. I'll just say, well, Chicago. Chicago ruins quarterbacks. Period. Chicago ruins quarterbacks.
All right, and best quarterbacks here. Best quarterbacks, and I think this is pretty... I looked at three different forums real quick. Best quarterbacks at Chicago. Number five, Jimmy Harbs.
Boy, that's bad.
Number four, Mitch Trubisky.
Oh, no.
Number three is Jim McMahon.
He was only on number the two, list because...
Whoa, hold on. Yeah. Number two is Jay Cutler.
I was expecting Jay Cutler number one.
Number one before the passing... Before the passing era really came to, back in 1939 to 1950.
Doesn't count.
Sid Luckman.
Doesn't count because he was, they didn't throw the ball. That's not a quarterback conversation.
His completion rating of 51% for 14,600 yards, 137 touchdowns, 132 interceptions. That's your number one Chicago quarterback.
Yeah. Okay. If they say so. To me, it's Jay Cutler, but whatever. And Jay Cutler looked like he was ready to take over the world at one point in Denver. Now, there's a lot. That's a whole podcast talking about what went wrong with Jay Cutler. And there was and there's absolutely a reason why Denver was willing to trade him.
Mm. Yep, but... Man, yeah. I mean, I wish Fields all the best here, obviously, but...
Prove me wrong, please. Please prove me wrong.
Yeah, but man, he's got a lot of work to do. He's got a lot of work. And I mean, he's used to cold weather, so that's going to really help him out. He came up to Ohio, played in some cold weather, looked pretty good. So, I mean, we'll yeah, see.
He looked pretty good. Past couple years, he looked pretty good.
All right. So then in day two, so we had rounds two and three then. The next Buckeye coming off the is Pete Werner. Pete Werner heading on over to the Saints.
Austin, you still in the chat?
He is not.
Oh, no, because memory serves. Austin, big old hater on Pete Werner, and I was gonna make him apologize.
So Pete Werner heading on over to the Saints, and then a couple of picks later, Josh Myers heading up to Green Bay. Seems like Green Bay does pick a lot of Ohio State linemen.
Yeah, I would say so. I think they're a heavy Ohio State drafter. Obviously so are the Saints. That's been Buckeye South for a while now. Yes. Yeah, Packers, I think, have drafted their fair share of Buckeyes as well.
Mm-hmm, yep. And then heading to the next round, the third round. So the end of day two, we have White Davis heading on over to the Vikings. And I think this is a great fit. I know probably preaching to the choir here and a lot of other media has said this, but I really like Trey Sermon over at the 49ers. I think how the 49ers have their offense. And what we've seen Trey Sermon, especially towards the end of his one season at Ohio State.
Yeah.
I really like Trey Sermon with the 49ers offense.
Yeah, I think that's a great fit for him. I think it would have been an even better fit if Justin Fields was the quarterback there and they could have continued to play together. But yeah,
why couldn't the 49ers have drafted Fields there? I mean, could have done like what Urban did in the first round and got the quarterback and running back from the same school, right?
Gangland literally just said that.
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah. I, for real though, I'm not done being upset about Justin Fields, if I'm being honest with you, Kyle. I'm really not done being upset about this. Is it because of the medical condition? Is that why? Listen, and I'm not saying that Trey Lance can't be good. I'm not saying that. He might be good. Number three overall is a huge risk for someone who has not faced legitimate competition ever. We aren't even talking like Boise. We aren't even talking about a MAC quarterback. That's what I'm saying. Wentz did good, but that's a huge risk to take when you don't know. Was Wentz taken third overall? I don't believe he was. I'm not saying that a Division II quarterback can't be good, but I am saying that to me is a huge risk. I know he was a first rounder, but I don't think he was a number three. Now, was he number two overall?
Number two overall.
That's still stupid to me. I'm glad it worked out for everyone, but that's still stupid to me. I don't mind saying it. I think that's stupid. And again, it has worked out in the past. Maybe Lance will do it again. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm not saying Wentz is Tom Brady, but as far as getting your value out of a pick, I think everyone did okay there.
Yep. Yep.
He's not a bust.
I like Myers at the Packers. Wyatt Davis, I think, would be a good fit with the Vikings. I forgot. Also, missed out. Baron Browning also. I think it was the last pick in the third round.
Last pick of day two.
Over to Denver.
Yeah, last overall pick of day two. Baron Browning, to me, feels a lot like... help me out, chat. Ohio State linebacker, not Jerome Baker, plays for the Dolphins. Help me out. Someone help me out. I'm blanking on his name. I don't know if he still plays for the... Raekwon. Thank you. Raekwon. Reminds me a lot of Raekwon McMillan, where I believe... Yeah, I know he's not with them anymore. The Dolphins traded away their entire defense. What was I saying? It reminds me a lot of Raekwon McMillan, where I think he'll be a much better pro. Raekwon was fine at Ohio State, but really came into his own in the NFL. And Baron Browning has that sort of feel to me.
Mm-hmm. Yep. The one in the fourth round, Tommy Togiai, staying in state in the Buckeye state and going to the Browns. I think that's going to add more depth in that interior for that Cleveland defense. I mean, Cleveland defense was already pretty stellar from last season, and just adding more depth there. I think it's a good fit for just getting another big guy in there. Yep, going along right there next to Garrett as well. I think this is just a good overall just depth for Cleveland. So I'm glad that it worked out for Tommy. Leaving early at Ohio State and getting drafted in that fourth round.
So fourth round, you do have to start having the conversation of should Togiai should he have stayed? A quick just verbal poll down there in the chat. Do you leave early for a fourth round pick? Nomad says no. I'm not sure which one of my questions. He would have had a larger... Yes, he would have had a larger payday. Nomad says you leave. You do leave for a fourth? Well, Wade... We're going to have a conversation about Wade.
We'll get there.
But Wade is... More often than not, coming back helps you. And I know that did not work out for Shaun Wade, but more often than not, it does.
He believes he's whether it's true or not to himself. After he was drafted, he said, "I was betting on myself of leaving Ohio State early."
Well, Kyle, we'll have a Shaun Wade conversation. Believe me.
And it worked out best. No, this is for Tommy.
Togi.
Tommy said, "I was betting on myself, and it worked out for the best." So he believes that. It worked out and he's happy with his decision.
Well, and
so.
It's also worth noting that sometimes when you ask the NFL, because these players can basically file for an evaluation for the NFL to find out if, you know, should I leave? Should I not leave to help these guys make? Sometimes it comes back with, you're about a fourth round pick, but we also think that's your cap. So the feedback he got might have been, you're a fourth round pick, but you're a fourth round pick, and another year won't do, because maybe that's the feedback he got. You're a fourth round pick, period. And in that case, yeah, go. But I think if you have the opportunity to advance from a fourth round to a second round, I think you gotta come back, I believe.
Mm-hmm. But man, like, kind of comparing Tommy to, let's just even say Olave staying back here. Maybe Olave looks and says, hey, I think I'm a first round pick. But then look at who else was in this draft here. Three wide receivers in the top 10 picks there.
Yeah.
Devontae, Waddle, and Chase on the top 10 picks there.
Now, can Olave, what does maybe next year's defensive tackle class look like? I don't know. And by the way, no one knows. We can only really guess, because you don't necessarily know what sophomore is about to take a huge step as a junior and then leave early. You really never know. So I'm always hesitant. I'm worried kids actually, unless you can look at a class, like right now, if you looked at the quarterbacks who came out this year, a lot of them. So maybe, like, unless you can look at a class and say, it's absolutely loaded this year, and that's rare for it to be this loaded. Maybe I'll come back next year, but betting that net, because I don't think the defensive tackle position was overly crowded in the draft this year. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Are you talking about defensive tackles or quarterbacks when you say that, Gangland? QBs? Well, you and I agree on that, but Fields was not the second quarterback taken, so other people disagree.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
I didn't even get into the BYU kid. Don't. Yeah. And again, he might be good. He really, really might be good. But I'd rather have it's the slander on Justin Fields is unacceptable. Unacceptable. Yeah, no, absolutely unacceptable slander.
Absolutely. All right. Fifth round, Jared. Luke Farrell.
Reunited. Luke Farrell heading on over to Jacksonville. Reunited with Urban Meyer.
Yep. Urban Meyer recruited him, and now Urban Meyer drafted him.
Yep. Speaking of that, there are rumblings, little bits of rumblings that we might get a Tebow renaissance in the NFL.
Oh, we'll see. Yep. We'll see.
I'm not saying it's going to happen. I'm just saying, you know, why not a little bit of no, he's not. Nomad says, nope, Urban is smarter than that. Nomad, no, he isn't. Urban is an insanely intelligent person, and I'm not saying otherwise, but his loyalty trumps his intelligence. Urban's, he will be fired immediately. He won't be, because I know what the contract looks like, and no, he won't.
Luke Farrell there, a big target for Trevor Lawrence. Trevor likes to, I think overall, you got a rookie quarterback, and having that safe, big target tied in there, I think that's a good fit for Luke.
Yeah, absolutely. I think a great deal all around in the fifth round.
Mm-hmm. Probably the biggest surprise, well, maybe not surprise, but the biggest story in terms of Ohio State draftees, excluding Justin Fields dropping all the way to 11th, is Shaun Wade dropping all the way down in the fifth round, 160th overall, and is heading over to Baltimore.
Kyle, let's have a long conversation about Shaun Wade. And since we need to have a long conversation about Shaun Wade, I think it's time for an ad break first.
All right. Sounds good. Why don't you kick us off with the Iron Bean?
Iron Bean Coffee Company. I told you before, Iron Bean Coffee Company has a lot of great, a lot of great coffees. I didn't go over any of them, so let's do that now. There's the Fierce, which is what I'm drank this morning, as a matter of fact. There's the Fierce, which is a dark roast coffee made with 100% Arabica beans, highly caffeinated. If you're looking for a pure caffeine shot, here you go. Or if you're looking for a literal shot, like an espresso, the Integrity is the flagship roast over at the Iron Bean Coffee Company. And they specifically say if you're going to make espressos, this would be the one to use. So there's two of their dark roasts. Maybe let's take a look at a couple of their medium roasts. There's the Ride or Die, which is a gentle, distinctive version of the classic American breakfast cup. Brazilian yellow bourbon beans are used in this, and superb flavor on that. There is also the Drink from the Skull of Your Enemy, which is a traditional Indonesian coffee that is edgier and smokier. It's thick, creamy, chocolatey, has notes of cedar, tobacco, wine, spice. It's a banger right there. That's a real banger. That and the Cast Iron are two. Well, and the Ride or Die are. Look at the Ride or Die. The Cast Iron is a medium roast coffee made with 100% single origin Arabica beans. Guys, they're all good. I keep wanting to say which one's my favorite. And I keep failing and tripping over myself because I just like them all so much. It's amazing. And again, this coffee is integrity first. It's health first, again, with all of the beans being fair trade certified, USD organic. They're all fresh to order. These aren't sitting in a warehouse for weeks or months on end. All of it roast to order in small batches, not sitting around, not being wasted, not getting stale and old and gross. So you can buy your own coffee over at ironbeancoffee.com. That's Iron Bean Coffee, America's local coffee roaster.
This episode is also brought to you by our good friends over at the Mad Canadian Barbecue Company. Hey, Mother's Day is right around the corner, fellas. What better way than to give your own mother a good old rib for Mother's Day? Why don't you make some good old ribs here for Mother's Day next Sunday? Who doesn't like ribs, right?
You just keep doing your thing. I'm very confused right now, but you just keep talking.
All right. I like the reaction from Jared here. Some good seasonings to put on those ribs. Right, surprise your mother with some good ribs this weekend here.
Kyle, do you know which rub the Mad Canadian uses on his food truck ribs?
He uses. I am looking here.
I know.
All right. Why don't you tell us then,
Jared? The Two Border. It's not just for eggs. That's our thing.
Yes. The Two Border, their flagship seasoning mixed with maple sugar and red pepper flakes that he uses, end quote here, on all of our ribs here at the Mad Canadian Barbecue. Crisp, it gives a clean, crisp, sweet flavor, while the red pepper flakes add that just amount of right of kick to heat to that pork. Or you can add a little bit of the coffee and cue. Why not add a little bit of that little bit of caffeinated coffee into it, the right amount of barbecue seasoning to give that extra flavor on your pork. Or if you want to go a little bit spicy, let's go with the Discord here. The Discord, they tested it and believe they got it just right with our good friends over at our Discord.
That's right.
Has the right amount of kick, not as spicy as the Four Horsemen, but the right amount of kick. That's great. On those ribs. Or Jared, I mentioned it once, I'll say it again, the old fashioned, it mimics the classic drink, sweet, bourbony, and the right kick of bitter. Can't go wrong with that. Check out those and much, much more over at themadcanadianbbq.com. And that is themadcanadianbbq.com. Use that promo code sloopcast10 at checkout for 10% off your entire order. And surprise your mom with some good ribs. Mad Canadian Barbecue Company, where they have your butt covered.
I'm still very confused. It felt very like Adam and Eve. I'm not going to lie. Like, just because you're, because you said a rib. Your first one was just to say a rib. And I don't know. He was very confusing for me.
A rib. All right. Let's see here. Let's just end. Like,
get your mom an entire rack of ribs, or at least a half rack of ribs. They yes. refrigerate and heat up really well. Don't give your mom a single rib.
I don't know what's going on in the chat. We're just going to move on to Shaun Wade, Jared. We're going to talk about Shaun Wade dropping down to the fifth round, 160th overall to Baltimore.
Kyle, I feel the need here to defend Shaun Wade. There's been a lot of Shaun Wade slander among Ohio State fans, among Ohio State media, from you and I at times. I'm not going to pretend otherwise, and from the NFL. And I think that let's take a moment. Shaun Wade got birthed into a terrible situation this year. He had played some free safety at Ohio State. He had played slot corner at Ohio State. Then this was his one and only year to play corner at Ohio State. Add to the fact that they also then have a new defensive scheme. So you have a new defensive scheme. You have your first year at the position, 5 years in the program, COVID, new defensive coaches,
multiple players out.
And the fact that the secondary in general was just depleted, not getting a ton of help over the top. And, you know, Ohio State had a real hard time getting a second safety in there to go with Proctor all year. The linebackers were not super helpful in coverage. And I'm not saying Shaun Wade is, I'm not saying Shaun Wade had a great year. The defensive meetings were garbage. Yeah. Yeah, that's a great point, Gangland. There's been a lot come out about what was going on behind the scenes at Ohio State this last season. And there was a lot wrong with the defense. And Shaun Wade played his part in that. I'm not saying he actually had a great year and everyone's wrong. I'm not saying that. He had a rough year. But he was given a lot of hurdles to overcome. A lot of hurdles.
Yep. Yeah, I think he'll fit a lot better, kind of like what you said right at the start of your spiel here. Going to be better fit at inside the slot safety or even at a free safety. He's a big corner who plays big, long arms, and he's quick. And one of the best things about Shaun Wade that a lot of people really underestimated, his tackling skills. He doesn't really let too many people just get away from him tackling. When he tackles, he gets them down to the ground. He doesn't miss too many tackles. So I think Baltimore got their pick here in the fifth round.
Yeah.
Middle of the fifth round was very solid. It was they're getting a very solid inside corner, or even a free safety too. I think this is a great pick by Baltimore, whether you like Baltimore or not, if you're Stewart. I think it's a very, very valuable pick here.
Well, and the thing is that in the modern NFL, and I'm not saying Shaun Wade will definitely be a free safety, but in the modern NFL, your free safeties have to also be cover guys. This wasn't true 15 or so years ago, but it is true now.
Mm-hmm.
That's one of the things that has allowed Von Bell to have such a great career in the NFL is the fact that even though he's playing safety, he's a great cover guy.
Yep.
Because in the NFL right now, you have a lot of tight ends out there who are playing as wide receivers with, you know, the amount they go out into pass coverage. In the NFL nowadays, you have a lot of three wide receiver sets because the fullback is essentially dead. So
I mean look at a lot of those, like you said, those three wide receiver sets too. Those inside corner or those inside wide receivers are quick. Those are your quick moving quick slanting receivers, and Shaun Wade is very good at closing in. He has a very good, just that burst of speed getting to that wide receiver. Now we criticized him all year last year of him giving too much space to that number one wide receiver,
which, by the way, was schematic a lot of the time.
Like, it was, yeah.
I don't think it's fair to be mad at Shaun Wade for that. I believe he was doing what his coaches were telling him to do in those situations. And could I be wrong? Yeah, I could be wrong, but that is my belief.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, the more I think about this, as much as I think I'll get a lot of hate for this, is that I think Ohio State really put him in a bad situation to be that number one wide receiver. And it cost him a lot of initial money here.
Well, two thoughts on that. One, 2020 put him in a bad situation. I believe he could have succeeded in that role had stuff been normal. But again, Ohio State's defense, for a lot of reasons, this past season failed, especially in the secondary, but in a lot of places, and a lot of it having to do with the limitations of 2020.
Mm-hmm.
If it had been a regular season, I think his draft stock could have been completely different. Two, this is why he came back. He came back to be put in this situation. Last year, some of the stuff he got back from the scouts when he was being evaluated as a potential draftee, some of the criticism he got back was, well, he's only ever played slot. He's only ever played safety. We don't know if he can play on the outside. And the teams aren't going to spend a first round draft pick. You're not going to get that Jeffrey Okuda money getting no experience on the outside. So he, in his mind, needed experience. He needed to put himself on tape out there guarding the wide receiver one. So did Ohio State put him in that position? Yes. Did Ohio State put him in some bad positions this year? Yes. But as far as him coming back and being matched up against wide receiver ones, that's exactly what he wanted. That's exactly why he came back.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I think him being that inside corner, free safety, one of the best things about Shaun Wade is that run, being that coverage in that run defense. He does a really good job of making himself big, which he's a pretty good sized corner.
Very long.
Very long. I think he'll do really well in that inside, definitely not an outside corner.
Matt says, can we discuss Tebow some more? Literally everyone will be talking about Tebow all the time. I've already added enough noise to it. He's one of those media darlings that brings up so many. And I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to feed into that loop. Jonathan Cooper goes to the Denver Broncos.
Happy for him. Happy he got drafted here.
Yeah, absolutely. In many ways, in the seventh round, it's almost better not to be drafted, but don't tell me you don't want to be. It's one of those things where it's like logic versus emotion. Logically, it's best not to be drafted in the seventh round. Emotionally, you want that validation.
Yeah.
You want to feel wanted. You go in as someone who was drafted into the NFL, and that lasts forever. So, yep. Jonathan Cooper, I don't know if he's ever a starter by design in the NFL. But he absolutely has like that coach on the field mentality that would make him incredibly valuable to have on the depth chart. And just to have in your locker room. I think he's that type of guy. And
he's that player. Like you said, he'll bring that energy onto the field there. I mean, there's a reason that he's the first one to wear the block O.
Yeah.
It's given out. It's earned to get that, that jersey. So being the first to get that at Ohio State, means a lot. Like it shows a lot of his leadership and his work ethics. So hopefully it works out for him over at Denver or anywhere else that he ends up.
Kyle, the Bengals are continuing their insanely long streak of almost never drafting Buckeyes, but still ending up with a ton of Buckeyes on their roster as they signed Drew Chrisman after the fact. Drew Chrisman is one of our first.
Yeah. So the undrafted free agency. Yep. Drew Chrisman heading on over to the Bengals. Justin Hilliard as an undrafted free agent heading on over to the 49ers. Blake Hallbill heading on over to Tennessee. I like that one a lot. I think he may be able to get that job there. Because if I remember correctly, like they don't really have a kicker at Tennessee right now.
I can't tell you anything about the kicking situation with the Tennessee Titans. I'm not going to pretend like I know because I don't.
Jake Hausman heading on north to Detroit. And everyone's favorite linebacker, Tuff Borland, heading on over to Viking land.
And did you say Justin Hilliard already?
I did, yes.
Okay. So yeah, I think overall, I'd say this is played out not too dissimilarly than I expected. I think everyone, not everyone, I'd say most of the players fell within the expected range, but on the back end of the expected range.
Yeah.
There was certainly a time where we were convinced that Justin Fields was going third overall. Does Justin Hilliard get drafted if there's a combine? No. Because ultimately, when you're Hilliard, you just have this "I'm injury prone" sign hanging over your head. And that's unfortunate, but if you're an NFL GM, you have to consider that.
Yep. So that, Jared, that is 10 drafted Buckeyes for a second straight year. And the seventh time ever that 10 or more Buckeyes have been drafted in a single NFL draft.
That pretty good. Is correct, sir.
Pretty good. The most, for those that don't know, the most that a Ohio State team has ever had the most drafted in one season is back in 2004.
Yep. That's 14, those sophomores from the national title team.
Yep. 14 picks in 7 rounds. Now, which one's more impressive, Jared? Which one's more impressive? 14 in 7 rounds, or 5 years ago, that insane 2016 draft class, 12 in 4 rounds? Which one's more insane, 14 in 7 or 12 in 4?
It's getting 12 in just 4 rounds for sure. Just because it's, but had 5 in the first round that year? Is that correct? Eli Apple was in the first round. That would have been Joey Bosa, Eli Apple.
All right, here we go. So we got third pick, Bosa, Chargers. Fourth pick, Elliott to the Cowboys. Apple, 10th to the Giants. Decker to the Lions and 16, and Darren Lee to the Jets at 20. I'm just looking down here. Maybe the biggest steal here, Jared, if you go down to the middle of the second round, can't guard Mike. Yeah. Over to the Saints in the middle of the second, towards the end.
No.
Von Bell to the Saints. Then Adolphus Washington in the third round, Braxton Miller in the third round, Nick Vinette, I think was is having a pretty good career right now. Yeah. Was drafted by the Seahawks. And then the finish it off is Josh Perry, Chargers, in the beginning of the fourth round. So you can say 11 picks in three rounds.
By the way, Josh
fourth Perry, right at the beginning.
Joshua Perry is killing it on Big Ten Network, by the way. If you could buy stock, not draft stock, but just stock in a person's career, I'd be investing heavy right now. He has a bright broadcasting future ahead of him. Joshua Perry, buy stock now.
Yes. All right. So some notable names here as we're kind of moving away from Ohio State here. Just some notable names that I think he has more integrity, Nomad.
And I say that Joey Galloway's turned himself into one of those ESPN clowns. I'm heartbroken to say, because he's just one of my all-time favorites.
Yep.
But he's become one of those make news instead of discuss news type of people who I dislike.
Yeah. Some other notable picks here outside of Buckeye land here that I thought was noteworthy. Micah Parsons was originally one of the finalists for Ohio State to get, ends up in Dallas at the 12th overall pick. Mac Jones heading on over to New England, which I know is a big topic that every sports media is talking about right now. For you Cleveland fans, Greg Newsome.
By the way, Mac Jones, I would say, is probably I've said, like, there's the top two quarterbacks, and then there's a huge dividing line, and then the rest of the quarterbacks. I think I'd have him at number three. Way below Fields, don't get me wrong, but I think Mac Jones would actually probably have been my third quarterback taken.
Yeah, I have a hard time really pinpointing Mac Jones. Like, he had a great 2020. I'm not going to deny that. He had a great year, but look who he had.
Yeah.
Look who he had to throw to.
Yeah. And, you know, it's tough. But, you know, you could say the same thing about Justin Fields. Ohio State potentially could put two wide receivers in the first round next year.
Yes.
So you could say the same thing about Fields. Just saying.
Yeah, true. So Greg Newsome heading to Cleveland. A Ohio State target at the time, Jameson Carman, heading on over to Cincinnati. Rondale Moore, as every Buckeye fan knows, from Purdue, heading on over to Arizona.
That's a good scheme fit for him.
Yes. This one was interesting. I was surprised how far he fell. But again, he went really, he didn't really have a good 2020 year, but Chuba Hubbard.
Yeah.
All the way down in the fourth round and heading on over to the Panthers.
Running backs aren't valuable. Who was the top? Was Pittsburgh taking?
It was really weird. It was really weird seeing Carolina pick Chuba Hubbard based on who they have right now on their roster.
But that's the thing. Running backs are replaceable, and they have to be replaceable. Etienne and Najee were the only two running backs taken in the first round. Pittsburgh took Najee first. Is that right? I'm getting that order correct?
Yeah.
Yes.
Pittsburgh picked him first, I believe.
And then Jacksonville traded right up away. To grab yeah,
they traded up. They trade up, I think.
I'm pretty sure.
I think
sure
they traded up to get ETN.
Yeah, I know they did. But to me, running backs aren't valuable anymore. They're replaceable, they're interchangeable. Unless you either draft a running back in the top 10 or not. I was ahead of you on that one. You either draft a running back in the top 10 or in day three. And I just don't see any reason to draft a running back anywhere in between.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
They're either just that absolute game changer who it has to be taken, like I said, in that top 10, or you wait until the fourth round. That's just how I feel. I'd rather get two. I mean, well, look, you could have got Chuba Hubbard in the fourth round and Trey Sermon at the end of the third round. I'd much rather have like Trey Sermon and Chuba Hubbard versus just Najee Harris or just ETN. Anytime one of these great running backs gets picked third, fourth, fifth round, everyone's like, oh, it's a steal. But it's that way every year. So is it actually a steal, or is that just the value that we've come to expect from running backs? We're talking about making investments. We're talking about making investments. And running backs realistically are probably worth 4 or 5 years of investment. That's it. A quarterback can last you 15 years. An offensive tackle can last you 15 years. A defensive end can last you 8 to 12 years. Running back is like 4 to 5. That's it. Running backs aren't valuable because they're not a good investment. Mm-hmm. It's like buying a house versus buying a car. That's it.
Any other notable names from your list or anything that kind of caught your eye, Jared?
Nope. We really need to bust through these Ask Sloopcast questions.
All right, man. I tell you what, Jared, like after doing this so for the last few years here, Jared, like I know the first couple of years of like, all right, we got to somehow be able to talk for an hour now. Now it just seems like, oh wow. It's almost at the hour mark now.
Yeah.
All right. Let's get to some Ask Sloopcast questions. Nomad, which I think is in the chat here. Hi, Nomad. Is it time to make black and cocaine white official Ohio State colors?
Technically they are. If you go look at the Ohio State media guide, you can see their official color codes, and technically black and white are official Ohio State colors. But yeah, I love the all white unis. Yeah. Ohio State has 4 official colors. There's BB0000, otherwise known as Scarlet. There's gray, otherwise known as 666666. And if that offends anyone, I apologize, but that's what it is. And then you have FFFFFF and 000000, the otherwise known as black and white. Those are the 4 Ohio State official colors.
Mm-hmm. Another question from Nomad. Who was the better Ohio State running back for their time? Cassidy or Archie?
I'd say Archie. I think Archie was a game changer. And I don't mean like he could change a football game. I mean like a program changer, but so was Cassidy. It's impossible to compare across era, I think, but I'm going to go Archie because he has two Heismans. Mm-hmm. How do you go wrong there? But I mean, let's not forget that the one of the nicknames of the horseshoe is the house that Hopalong built or that Cassidy built. I forget which one of his names they use in that moniker, but yeah.
Yeah. Kabuto asks us, Jared, why does everyone say JSN's full 3-word name instead of either first or last only?
Instead of first or last only. So, well, first off, Smith Njemba is his last name. It's a hyphenated name. So it's not 3 name. I think you know that. I don't think you're suggesting that Smith is his middle name. I think you realize that. It's because Jackson is such a last name as a first name. Or did I say that backwards? It's such a first name as a last name No, I said it right the first time. It's such a last name as a first name. So when you just say Jackson, if you just say by his first name, I think when you just say Jackson, people automatically try to associate it to a last name. Mm-hmm. And then I think people pronounce the full last name because it almost feels like maybe it's disrespectful not to. Nomad says, Little Nomad has four Jacksons on his baseball team. I assume you mean first name Jacksons? Is this correct, or are there quadruplets? Popular first name these days. So what you're saying is that JSN was way ahead of his time, as I assume that, or rather his parents were.
And he doesn't spell it the with the CKS.
That's true.
Mm-hmm. Nomad here asks, how do you properly pronounce 2020?
Kyle just did it. Ohio State is looking good on the pursuit of Tennessee transfer linebacker 2020. And yes, that mm-hmm. is how you pronounce it. We are nailing it. Don't tell me otherwise. Ohio State. If Ohio State can get 2020, enormous, immediate starter. It's huge for Ohio State. Ohio State's defense is immediately better. He's an immediate starter. Mm-hmm. This is huge.
And no, Tom, it was not in your guide here.
It's not his guide. That's Ohio State's guide.
Yes. It wasn't the guy that you shared with us from Ohio State.
I actually asked, it was on the Buckeye Scoop board, which I mostly just read. I don't post a lot over there. But I actually, when like conversations first started happening about 2020 potentially coming to Ohio State, I responded to Alex Gleitman saying, hey, for no particular reason, how do I pronounce this?
All right. Stuart asks us, why didn't Sunshine say his new daddy's name when being interviewed?
I don't know. I don't think I saw the interview. If I did see it, I didn't retain it.
I didn't either. Speaking of, I want to say this for the record.
Trevor Lawrence is amazing. He's a great quarterback. He's going to be a great quarterback in the pros. And I like him. And I'm tired of pretending that I don't.
Mm-hmm. Did you see the picture? There's a picture that's floating around.
I'm sorry. Real quick. Nomad says he's overrated. Well, he's the first overall pick. So it's literally impossible for him to be underrated because he's number one. So you can't say he's underrated because it's literally impossible because he's number one overall. And has been his entire life, by the way.
Yep. So the picture that's been floating around the past couple of days here is with Trevor Lawrence at home and Dabo coming in. Did you see...
Was that at home or I think that was in Cleveland?
No, at home. I believe... Okay. No, that's Dabo at Trevor Lawrence's home. Did you see the suit that Dabo had?
The man is not a classy man. And in Dabo's defense, he doesn't pretend to be...
Goodness,
that is not a dapper man.
Dude makes $10 million a year, however much he makes, and he doesn't have a person to fit him properly. Like that looks like just like what Gangland said here. He looks like a homeless man wearing a suit.
No, I think he looks more like a teenager wearing his dad's suit.
When you get a suit, there's part that you have to cut off so that it actually fits properly. And he still has the tag on it or the string on it.
Because he's taking it back to Kohl's when he's done.
He borrowed one from Jackson Carman. Maybe.
That's what I'm saying. He looks like a teenager borrowing his dad's suit. That's what he looked like.
Pretty good analogy. Yeah. I mean, you see Lawrence there, and he looks like he actually got fitted properly. Like it fits him. It looks good on him. And then you have,
he's got that Dabo, agent money
just,
now.
It's just big cuffs and just baggy pants. It's like, that's not a way to wear a suit. If you're going to go out and wear a suit, get honestly, anybody, if you're a first time suit owner, get it properly fitted, get somebody to properly fit you, because if you go out and try to do it yourself, it's going to look bad. You're going to look just as bad as
that. I don't want to say that, because I don't assume people have that kind of money. And not that getting it tailored is super expensive, but the point is that learn to buy something that fits you properly. There's no excuse for Dabo. Dabo has money.
You can go to certain stores. Like I got a couple of suits at Banana Republic.
Yeah.
And I talked to somebody there and tried on a few different suits and got the right size and all that. And thankfully for my size, I didn't have to get altered and all that too. So, talk to somebody, not just
what Gangland just said, at least get your measurements. Not everyone has the money to get something custom tailored. I've never bought anything custom tailored. Nope. I've never done that. That feels like a financial step above my means, even if it's not. But it just definitely feels like something that someone with more money than me would do. I've never done it, but just like Gangland said, at least get your measurements.
Yep. let's see what other questions we have here. Gangland here. Can we talk about Wade's? Okay. We did talk about Wade's stock drop as a result of scheme and lack of proper defense meeting, plus injury, instead of him getting shit on. Someone who knows football understands there's a lot more than man on man.
I believe we did that. And I'm reading between the lines of what you were attempting to get us to say, Gangland, I believe we agree.
Yes.
I think we already did that. And yes, we agree. And although we didn't even bring up the fact that he was fighting injuries all year as well.
Yeah.
That's not something we brought up, but you know, I feel like a lot of players are fighting injuries. So I don't know how severe his was versus no one's healthy by the end of the year. But yeah.
Austin, when's the last time you went to Sonic? Do you have a favorite Sonic drink?
The second part of that, no, I don't have a favorite Sonic.
I want to say the last time that I had it, and it may be yours as well, Jared. This was a long time ago when I still lived in Columbus. I think we went to see a movie with a couple of our buddies up at Polaris. And then there's that Sonic that's right there. I think that might be the last time. That was like 12 years ago, something like that.
I was about to tell the same story.
Okay.
Yeah. That's the last time I've been to a Sonic.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Same here.
And I have to say, I don't think it was either of our choice. I think it was like we were waiting on a movie and killing time.
All right. Last question here. If you want to answer this or not, Jared.
Okay.
Nomad asks if we want to talk about Mac Jones putting physique in his suit.
Nope. Letting that one go. Okay.
I saw somebody else compared him. He looks like a Lego as well.
Letting it go.
All right. All right. That is it, Jared. That is all we have for today's episode.
I'm not going to say it because it's mean, but our homie Suncard gave the perfect analogy for Mac Jones in our Discord. And it's a little too mean to repeat. So if you want to know, you should have been in the Discord live chatting with us on draft night one. All right, Kyle, that's it. That's the end of the show. Just come visit all the stuff. You can visit our t-shirt stores. I'm wearing something from our 7071 store. You can find that by going to 7071.thesloopcast.com. You can check out Kyle's t-shirt over there, which is available at merch.thesloopcast.com. You can buy your very own We've Got Barbecue t-shirt. And we have lots of merch. Come on over. As I said, I think we mentioned a couple times, you should join our Discord. You can join that by going to discord.thesloopcast.com. If you don't know what a Discord server is, it's basically like an organized group text or a sort of like a, it's like a private little chat server. That's all it is. Nothing to be intimidated by. It's a private little chat server. Follow us on Twitter, I guess. I think I'm averaging less than 20 tweets a week at this point. So hey, follow me on Twitter. Don't, I don't care. Join the Discord. If you want to talk to us and have conversations with us, join the Discord. That's where we hang out mostly at this point. And come support us. By joining up at the Patreon, patreon.thesloopcast.com. For as little as $3 a month, you can support us, get access to the, you can join these wild bunches down here talking to us while we record. We're going to be doing more, I believe, like live chats, something Kyle and I are still discussing. So no promises there, but during the spring game, we all watched it together and had a live conversation. Yahoos. Nomad says that they're Yahoos. We're going to do more of that during the football season. We're going to do more like live watch alongs. I'm not probably like some non-Ohio State games. We'll do some watch alongs and like for Ohio State's less intense games, like against MAC schools or whatever, we'll probably do some watch alongs. No promises on any of that yet, but you will have to be a part of the Patreon group to participate in the conversation. So that's a thing to keep in mind. So, and again, that's $3 a month. And I believe it's like it's less than $33 if you pay for the whole year up front. So that's the other thing. You can save, I think it's like 10% by paying for the entire year up front. So that's also an option for you. You save a little bit of cash that way. And you avoid, like, I know a lot of people just don't like having monthly recurring stuff on whatever. And I get that. So you can save some money and just pay for a year up front. And you can do that over at patreon.thesloopcast.com. Kyle, I need to quit talking now. What do you have in Kyle's corner?
Honestly, don't really have much. Actually, really anything at all. One name that I did not mention here that I thought his name was going to be mentioned here. I mean, he was a 4-star top 50 player that did not get drafted, who committed to Ohio State. Did not get drafted.
Grimes?
Trevion Grimes did not get drafted.
Yeah. He had like real strong, I don't want to say like Chris Carter Tathan vibes to him. Tathan's still grinding things out in college ball. I always liked Grimes. He didn't really live up to his skill set, I think. And I think I'll leave it at that.
It does look like he did sign an undrafted free agency with the Eagles.
And I'm not super familiar with what's going on with the Eagles as far as their wide receiver depth. So I'm not 100% sure how that may or may not play out for him. But, you know, more power to him. I know he had a lot of troubles during his freshman year that were not of his fault at Ohio State. He was having some issues with the family, with some health stuff. And I know that probably really hurt his development in many ways. So I just all the best luck to him for sure.
Yep. Yeah. Nothing else I got. Crew hasn't won a game yet, but they haven't lost either yet. and Blue Jackets are just bad. So that's it. That's all I got.
We knew that was going to happen.
Yes. All right. That's all I got for today's episode, Jerry.
All right. That's it. That's the episode. So tonight's ending music will be by a band out of Cleveland called Signals Midwest. Just kind of a alt-rocky sort of band. I think we'll just say alt-rock. And you can check them out on their Bandcamp page, which I will link to below, or on their YouTube page, which I will probably link at least to the song below. So you can check them out. And that's it. Yeah, I think that's it. So with all that being said, I'd like to encourage everyone to drink local beer, listen to local music, and of course, support your local podcasters. Once again, this is Signals Midwest. What's up, YouTube? This one's for YouTube. This one's just for YouTube. I'm going to double check. I believe it is music.thesloopcast.com. We'll actually link you to our Ohio only music page or YouTube playlist. So we have a playlist of most of the songs we've played over the years, and I always am trying to update it. So it's just a playlist available to you on YouTube, available to everyone on YouTube. And I believe you can find it just by either visiting our Sloopcast YouTube page, or you can, I believe it is music.thesloopcast.com, I believe is. And then, by the way, if that's not right, just go to thesloopcast.com and you'll be able to find the link there, along with all of our other links as well. Yeah, Nomad, just so that doesn't happen.
And if you have something that you want us to have a topic about, let us know in the
Discord
comment, or better yet, hit us up in the Discord.
Nah, don't leave anything in the comments.
All right.
I don't
hit us up in the Discord.
I don't read YouTube comments.
Let
Discord,
us
sloopcast@gmail.com. That's where you send questions.
There you go, Galen. Yes.
Yeah, so that's it. Kyle, let's end the show. Once again, I'd like to thank Signals Midwest for ending today's show. And I would once again like to thank the Iron Bean Coffee Company for sponsoring today's show. You know, we have Mother's Day coming up. Father's Day's not too far behind. Just get them some coffee. Yeah, you can get the whole shebang, which is a big old sampler pack. They can find the coffee that's just right for them. If you think that they think what coffee they are going to want, then you can go ahead and get them a gift card. You get free shipping over $50. If they find that one coffee that's perfect for them, they can save money, or you can save money if you're buying for yourself, with a subscribe and save service. And just know that you're supporting a company that does things the right way, a company that operates on the basis of integrity. You're talking about fair trade certified beans, USDA certified organic beans, veteran owned company, small roaster, small batch roaster, fresh to order roaster. And again, veteran owned, Marine owned, Toledo, Ohio based. What else? It's local, it's military, it's organic, it's fair trade certified, it's fresh, it tastes great. What box is not being checked right now, and why haven't you bought from the Iron Bean Coffee Company yet? What are you waiting for? Unless of course you have. It is vegan. That's right, Gangland. None of these coffee beans had mothers. That is absolutely true. Unless you add creamer to it, but that's your choice. It's your choice to add cream. Unless it's almond-based creamer, in which case you're back in the clear. That's it. That's all I have. Go to ironbeancoffee.com. That's Iron Bean Coffee, America's local coffee roaster.
This episode is also brought to you by our good friends over at the Mad Canadian Barbecue Company. Three box sets that you can purchase for your mother. if she's into grilling, we got the Mad Canadian has three great box sets. Moms that you could too, okay? Surprise your mother, or better yet, you could surprise your mother by using one of these box sets for Mother's Day here.
We aren't about gender roles here. Mom can use the grill. Dad can use the oven. It's fine.
Yes. The three box sets that the Mad Canadian has here, and again, these box sets are a combined versatile seasonings of each one of each box. It consists of different seasonings. The one here is the Just Send It. It's a very versatile, as I mentioned before, it's your basic starter. It's your introductory to seasonings, your S&P, your salt and pepper mix, Sonoran Heat to give you that little kick, that Cajun to give you that Mexican flavor, or the smoked, just for that smoky flavor there. Again, that is the Just Send It, the Sweet Heat. If you want something that's a little spicy, a little sweet, or a little bit of both, I personally call this the Chicken Wing set. And the Mad Canadian also defines that as well. The Four Horsemen,
I think you
very, very it, spicy. The Discord, not as spicy, but still pretty spicy. The Old Fashioned, mentioned multiple times already. And the Two Porter, I mentioned earlier as well. Or if you can't decide, why not get the Whole Hog, one of each of the seasonings that the Mad Canadian has developed currently in his Mad Lab. Check those out and much, much more over at themadcanadianbbq.com. Again, that's themadcanadianbbq.com. Use that promo code to save 10% more by using Sloopcast10, Sloopcast10 at checkout for 10% off your entire order. Mad Canadian Barbecue Company, where he has your butt covered.